Welcome to part 2 of the Skeletal Animation tutorial mini-series. Okay, quick recap from part 1. We created a small utility to load the bone-related stuff from Assimp. Assimp holds the model in one or more mesh structures, and each mesh points to an array of bones, and each bone points to an array of the vertices that it influences. For each vertex, we have an index and a weight, which is a floating point number between 0 and 1 that represents the amount by which the current bone influences this vertex. At the end of part 1, I left you with the challenge of mapping the vertices back to the bones that influence them. Okay, so maybe I was a bit too dramatic. Anyway, this video is going to be very technical, and the focus will be on implementing this mapping and making sure that it is working correctly. Now, since the core principle in this mini-series is to work in a step-by-step fashion, we're going to implement it first in the Assimp utility, and then move this logic over to the main application. I also want to visualize the relation between the bones and the vertices, so in today's demo, you'll be able to actually see the effect that each bone has over the vertices. In this example, the red triangles represent vertices that are highly influenced by the current bone, and this influence decreases as we move from red to yellow and then to green. The blue triangles represent vertices that don't receive any influence from the current bone. You can click the space bar and switch between the different bones. This part of the fragment shader is not required in the final implementation, but I think that if you're implementing this in your own code, it will be a good debugging step just to make sure that everything is loaded correctly into the GPU. Okay, so let's jump back into Assimp sandbox.cpp, and we start by including the map, string, and vector headers from the C++ standard library for the data structures that we will need here. Next, we have a macro, which defines the maximum number of bones per vertex. 4 bones is enough for my model, so just tweak this to make it match your assets. Next, we have the vertex bone data structure that contains 2 arrays. One for the indices of all the bones that affect this vertex, and for each bone, we also have a corresponding weight. I'll skip the rest of this structure for now. Next, we have 3 new data structures. We have a vector of the vertex bone data for each vertex. This is basically the mapping from the vertices back to the bones that influence them. We have a vector of integers called mesh base vertex. The Assimp scene class contains meshes which contain bones, and each bone references the vertices of the mesh in which it is contained as if they start at 0. We're going to pack all the vertices together in a single array called VertexToBones, so we want to map the relative vertex index to a unique global vertex index, and we do that by calculating a base vertex for each mesh and adding the relative vertex index to this base. Finally, we have a map from bone names to their indices because Assimp uses strings for the name of the bones, but for us it will be much more straightforward to work with bone indices. So now let's jump down to main, and we've seen this in part 1, so very briefly, main calls parseScene, which calls parseMeshes, and here we resize mesh base vertex using the number of meshes in the scene. So for each mesh, we have a base index, which we need to calculate, and we do this right here. The total number of vertices is increased for each mesh, so before we increase it for the current mesh, we save the current total number of vertices as the base. We also resize vertex to bones based on the updated total number of vertices because we're going to need this space when we parse the mesh. Now, this is not the most efficient way to do this, but for a utility like that, this is okay. Basically, this vector is resized again and again for each new mesh with just enough space for this mesh. Finally, we call parseMeshBones, and you may notice that I added the index of the current mesh because we're going to need it later. parseMeshBones didn't change. We simply call parseSingleBone for each bone with the addition of the mesh index in the first parameter. In part 1, this function simply printed all the vertices that are affected by the current bone and their weights. I added some code here to create the mapping from the vertices back to the bones. First, we get the bone ID, which is a unique index for each bone. Inside the loop, we calculate the global vertex ID by adding the vertex ID from the AI vertex weight structure to the base vertex ID of the current mesh, which we set in the parse meshes function, right here. Each mesh has a batch of vertices, and the bones that reference them use indices that start at 0. We want to stack up all the indices of all these batches together, one after the other, because we're loading it like that to the vertex buffer, so we have to make these indices unique. So the first batch starts at 0, and then the base of the next batch starts with wherever the previous batch ended. Let's jump to getBoneID, which maps the name of the bone to its unique index. We have a map between a string and an integer called boneNameToIndexMap. If the name already exists, we just return the index, and if not, we set the mapping, and the boneID simply increments automatically as we add more items into the map. Back to parseSingleMesh. Now that we have the global vertex ID, we use it to access the vertex-to-bones array, which, I remind you, is a vector of vertex-bone data structure, and we call addBoneData with the index of the current bone and the weight, which is coming from the AI vertex weight structure. This function searches for a free slot in the weights array and places the bone ID and the weight in that slot. We assume that if the weight is 0, then this slot is free because the weight must be greater than 0 if the bone actually influences that vertex. Once we find the free slot and do the update, we can exit the function. If we can't find a free slot, there will be an assertion because either you have a bug or you need to increment the maximum number of bones per vertex. Now let's run this on our boblamclean.md5 mesh file. And you can see that we get the vertex ID, the bone index, the weight, and the index of the slot where this info was recorded. Let's do a bit of Oak magic. Let's grab vertex and have Oak print just the values in this line, okay? So we have the vertex ID at index 3, bone index at 5, weight at 7, and slot at 9. Works okay. We can sort this numerically by the vertex IDs, and we can see that the first vertex is fully influenced by bone number 2, the second vertex is influenced by bones 2 and 3, and we got their weights at slot 0 and 1, so this makes sense. Vertex 8 is influenced by 11, 2 and 3, so this looks okay as well. If you want, you can check this more thoroughly, but I think that for now it is okay. The next step will be to integrate this piece of logic into our OpenGL application and actually load the indices and weights of the bones per vertex into a vertex buffer. We can then access it from the vertex shader and do cool stuff like applying some color to all the pixels that are affected by a certain bone. Again, this is just for debugging, but we're making progress in small steps, and making sure at each step that everything is working correctly is very helpful. For the integration, I copied OGLDEV basic mesh header and CPP files into this directory, and I renamed them skinnedmesh.h and CPP. The next tutorial will include a new version of the same files in its own directory, so you'll be able to compare the two revisions. OGLDEV basic mesh was already covered in a previous tutorial. I'll put a link below to that video. Right now, we'll just cover the skeletal animation related code. This class is called SkinnedMesh, same as the header, and here we have the max number of bones per vertex. Vertex bone data is here as a private declaration, and it is the same one as in the sandbox, so no need to go over it. We're going to use a new vertex buffer for the bones in addition to the index, position, texture coordinates, and normals, so we have a new enum for the bone vertex buffer. We have the declarations of three functions that I simply copied from the sandbox as is: load mesh bones, load single bone, and get bone ID. I use the word load instead of parse because it is more common in this class. We have a vector of vertex bone data, again, same as the sandbox. We're going to use it to populate the vertex buffer of the bones, and finally, the map between the bone name and its index. Now let's go to the CPP file. We have two new vertex attribute locations for the vertex shader. This will allow each vertex to access its list of bones and their weights. Make sure to keep these numbers synchronized with the vertex shader. In the reserve space function, we are resizing the bone vector based on the number of bones. Okay, so this is the same as all the other buffers here. In init single mesh, I added a call to load mesh bones, which calls load single bones, which uses getBoneID to map the name of the bone to its index. Okay, so again, this works the same as in the Assimp utility. Basically, when the processing of the scene structure is complete, we have all the mapping from the vertices to bones in this mBones vector, and then in the populate buffers function, we bind and allocate the new bone vertex buffer. We also enable the two vertex attributes to access the bone IDs and weights. We also need to set the layout correctly, so for the bone IDs, make sure to use glint and not glfloat as all the other attributes. We have four integers for the four IDs, followed by four floats. Make sure to set the offset correctly for the second attribute. We have the max number of bones times the size of a bone ID, so we should get 16 bytes here. Okay, 4 bones times 4 bytes per integer. Now I want to make sure that the bone vertex buffer is populated and loaded correctly, so in this demo we will paint the triangles that are affected by each bone using a specific color. Let's see how to do that. In the vertex shader, we have two new input attributes for the bone IDs and the weights. Notice that the IDs are IVEC and not a regular VEC. The regular VEC is for floating points and the IDs are integers, so we must use IVEC. The vertex shader simply copies the two attributes out to the fragment shader, so we also need to declare them as output attributes. Here, we meet the type qualifier flat for the first time. We're used to having the rasterizer interpolate attributes such as colors and texture coordinates across the triangle face, but in the case of the bone IDs, it doesn't make any sense, so this flat qualifier basically tells the rasterizer, don't interpolate, simply copy the attribute as is. We have a corresponding declaration in the fragment shader, and we must use flat here as well. If we forget it, we will get an error that says that integer varying must be flat. The rest of the fragment shader was simply copied from a previous tutorial on lighting, and the only change is in the main function. We loop over the number of bones and we check each slot in the bone IDs attribute, whether this is equal to display bone index, which is a uniform attribute set by the application. We're going to see that in a minute. If this is true, we want to set the output color, and here I try to mimic the behavior of Blender. Okay, so in Blender, if you go to Wind Paint mode, you can switch between the vertex groups, which is basically the bones, and then the blue vertices are not affected by the selected bone at all, the red is highly affected, and the green and yellow are somewhere in between. I try to do a similar thing in the fragment shader. Okay, it's not perfect, but it's pretty usable. If the weight of the current bone is more than 0.7, we output red, modulated by the weight, because it looks like Blender also uses the weight to interpolate the color. Between 0.4 and 0.6, we use green, and then yellow for anything else above 0.1. If the bone index is not found for this pixel, we use blue. I also multiply the original color that comes from lighting by a small fraction in order to disable its effect. I didn't use zero, so that the compiler will not yell at me that the lighting stuff is not really used. The application code is pretty standard, so no need to go over everything. The only thing to note here is that when spacebar is pressed, we increment the current display bone index. We use modulo to make sure we don't overflow the number of bones, and then we set this index into the fragment shader. The fragment shader has a uniform integer for this index, and this is what we use for checking the bone ID. Now let's see how this works. So the next step is to understand the matrices that control the transformation of the vertices during the animation. All this and more will be covered in the next tutorial. If you enjoyed this video, please hit the like button and subscribe. Thank you so much for watching, and I will see you in the next tutorial on skeletal animation.